Good evening. Does everybody hear me now? Is this sound okay? Thank you. Well, given that Jaap just mentioned the book called Future of Money, I propose to start with that. This was a book that I published in 1999. And the hope for that book was to avoid that we are where we're now. I obviously miserably failed. The book had four, the core thesis was the following, that before 2020, we're going to be forced to change fundamentally our monetary system for the first time in centuries on a fundamental level. And in some respects, for millennia. And the reason for that was that there are four megatrends which would force us to do that because they have no solution within the current monetary pipeline. The first one of these was the age wave, which is a totally predictable thing. Okay, everybody involved was alive. And it would actually make it possible provide the elderly with the money matching the longevity. When the whole idea of pensions was invented by Bismarck in the 18th century, the life expectancy in Germany was 48. So having a pension at 65 was a pretty safe thing to do. Of course, everything has changed. And now, there's a study actually done by the Bank of International Settlements in 2010 that shows that Europe will go only on the basis of that part to 300% to 500% of GNP in terms of external debt, government indebtedness. Obviously, this will not happen. Okay? But it was predicted. The second one is the information revolution, which you all heard very nice things about. But they forgot to mention it's also the end of the Industrial Age. And the Industrial Age is when jobs were invented. The word job in English did not exist until the Industrial Revolution. Work is a word that exists. Jobs, no. Jobs is something you do to get money. Okay? Job work is something you do because you like it. Okay? So, jobs will disappear with the Industrial Age. And the opening of China just accelerated that process, but it did not create it. The third one was climate change and biodiversity extinction, which at the time was told was a problem that didn't exist, at least for the Americans. We know a little better now. We have a systemic conflict between corporate thinking and survival of society. Corporations are not, I insist, not competing for markets and resources, as every one of your textbooks say. They are competing for money, using markets and resources, which is not the same thing. Okay? The proof is that they will drop a market and a particular resource as soon as there's not money to make on it. And they'll move to something that creates money. Now, money, or conventional money, any currency with a positive interest rate, by definition, the future doesn't count. If you be a rational investor, think for 100 years from now, don't matter. So we have a systemic conflict between the money system and what society needs, which is long-term thinking. And finally, monetary instability. I was told that it only exists in developing countries. This is not something that is actually going to happen to us. Well, we know better by now. So, these four megatrends: number one, For the last 20 years, I have defied any audience, and that includes you today, to give me a solution within the current monetary paradigm to any one of those four. Of course, we could resolve that. Kill the people that are over 65. That's one way of doing it. But, I mean, there's always that the solution that would actually be something that people would accept. I have not had an answer for 20 years. If anybody has a reaction, we don't have to wait till the end, you can tell me. About any one of the four. On the other hand, what I claim, there are solutions. If you leave the monetary paradigm, and I'll tell you what that is in a few minutes, for all these problems, plus a bunch of others. But it requires us to get out of the box. And we have been trained to think within the box. How many of you have gotten a course in economics? Good Lord. There's a hell of a lot of stuff to get rid of. Okay? You're hereby warned. Sorry, guys. All right. We are trying to meet the challenges of the 21st century with a toolbox. The box itself is 5,000 years old. Was Sumer. And we're using modern tools which date from the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. Actually, we made the Industrial Revolution possible in England. So that's the toolbox we're using. Now, anybody who believes that we're going to be meeting the challenges of the information age with the toolbox of the industrial age, let me give you the parallel. What would it be in the industrial age? We are at the beginning of the industrial age. You say everything will change with the industrial age, except horses. Right? Because we believe that the money system cannot change. It cannot change. We've been trained to believe that it is the only way of organizing our society. And this is not innocent, by the way. There were some brilliant guys working 300 years ago on making that work. They institutionalized their interest in a brilliant way. They used semantics. The word semantics did not exist 300 years ago. They used semantics at a level of sophistication, which is rare today, to make us stuck in that mode. But given that you all have courses in economics, you will all have the answers to these questions, right? Four simple questions. Who creates money? Who creates money? How many of you believe it's a government? That's okay, one, two, three, okay, a few. How many of you believe it's the central bank? Okay, about at least half, actually a little more. Who any believes that it's someone else? Two, three, three, four. The last ones have it. All of you have no clue who creates money, except four people. I think this is interesting. Because that's supposed to be what you're about, right? The School of Business and Economics. Right? Sorry, guys. How is money created? Is it the printing press? Well, every television show shows always the printing presses running on euros or dollars when you talk about that, right? A couple of them there. Anybody else? Is it by debts from banks? Okay, again, a small smattering. Every euro you have seen, every dollar you have seen, every yen you have seen is someone's debt. Okay? Created out of nothing. It's called fiat money. They say it in Latin to make sure you don't get it. Fiat lux was the first word that God said in the Genesis. Right? That light be. And the secret is, light was, ex nihilo, out of nothing, the power of the word of God. That's how money is created, all our modern money. Another little bit. What's the difference between capitalism and communism? Guess what? Everything except money They're using the same system. Bank debt money. The only difference is in the communist system, the Soviet system, the banks were the shareholders. Sorry, the governments were the shareholders of the banks. In the capitalist system, that only happens when the banks are in trouble. Okay? That is the difference. The system is the same. Isn't it shocking? It shocked me when I discovered that. So, is there a law that says that you're not supposed to use anything but euros in Holland now? Was there a law that says you're only supposed to use gulden? How is the monopoly enforced? Anybody has an idea? Yes?
By the government.
Government.
Yeah, government.
And what does government say?
Government creates legislation which enforces the use of certain currency in our country. Like in most of the territories.
Okay, are you saying that two companies in Holland are not supposed to
wait for my...
Okay, what he's saying is that government is behind it. You're right and wrong. Because you're right in the sense that government is doing it. However, which is something that even Bill Gates could not dream of, right? Having a monopoly enforced for you by the government.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Good. However, it's not done by a law. They may have laws about it, but that's not the mechanism. Two corporations in Holland and two individuals can change. I can change this with this, do you?
No.
Right? I can change my tie with your jacket. But however, if I make a profit on it, I have to pay my taxes. And my taxes, I have to pay them in?
Europe.
There we go. The purpose of taxes is not to fund the government. It's to give value to a currency that has none. Get this? You see the scale? Fine. Good. So, it's not by law, because actually there's no law against having barter even. By the way, 15 to 20% of global trade is happening without any currency. Today, we're not talking small stuff. Okay? And it's growing three times faster than denominated in national monies of any kind. So, however, it is by taxes. That's the key. Good. Now, what is money? I'm sure you all know about that. Because that's in page 2 of Economics 101, right? Right? Wrong. Wrong. What's in all your textbooks, and I'm still looking for another textbook in any language that actually doesn't define money as functions. It is a standard of measurement, a medium of exchange, and a store of value. Sorry, guys, that's a function, not the nature. You understand the difference? Now, if you define something functionally, let's assume that we have no word for transport in English. We only have the word horses. Nobody would ever invent a bicycle. You would only perfect horses. You see the trap? The functions are covered. Therefore, nothing new is needed. Okay? That is what money is, according to my proposal. It's an agreement. It lives in the same space as a wedding, a marriage, a political party, a business contract. Within a particular community, it has used to be for the last 300 years, national communities, but to use something standardized as a medium of exchange. Now, what's interesting about the definition in terms of an agreement is what? If an agreement doesn't work, you can change it. If you have a definition in terms of function, you cannot change it. It's there. Always. It's there. So, that's part of the traps. Good. I'm emphasizing that the medium of exchange function, of the three functions, as the one that actually determines what money is. Because there are other forms of store of value. No. Then, a house is a store of value. Okay? Not only money. Good. Or a painting. Good. So, this is my plan. I'm going to give a few facts, already given you a few, all right? I'm going to give you a few more terminologies. And then I'll have been announced that I'll be talking about why and how we need to change. And I'll have a very quick conclusion. If you look at the history of these mediums of exchange, there are about 5,000 years of well-documented history. Okay? And there are only three times that technology has changed, which is extraordinary. I mean, think about the number of things that have changed in transport over time, okay? Or in anything else, food. The first one was, in the commodity period, which includes things like gold coins and silver coins, commodity, intrinsic stuff, the sovereigns were in charge. Because the kind of form that the money took has influenced, not immediately, it didn't take one day, it took a couple of centuries to evolve. We have 5,000 years to work with. And sovereigns were in charge of commodity money, because they actually controlled the area where the commodity was available, or was extracted, or whatever. And I'll give you a couple of examples. Paper money shifted the power of creating money from sovereigns to banks. And we're now in digital money. 95% of all money on the planet is bits in a computer somewhere. So we are a completely digitalized economy, where money is completely digitalized. You look at your own money, whatever amount it is, look how much is in your pocket, your paper, and how much is in other forms. Okay? And it is the vast majority. Now, I believe that we are at a tipping point where it is possible that the power shifts. And it could take a century or two. I don't know. Some people will be faster than others. But, you know, something is possible to shift from out of the box simply because of the technological shift. Here are some examples of commodity money. The top one is bronze ingots. Bronze had been traded from 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 BC to basically historical times. And that was money. The Mycenaean economy was based on that, for example. Another one is salt. The word salary comes from Latin, and people were paid in salt. They were since the 19th century.
Well, in 20th century, people in the USSR were paid in toilet paper.
Yes. Let me propose the rules of the game for interaction. I'm going to ask you something, you can answer, of course. But if you don't understand something, stop me. If it's a question of understanding, stop me. If we start a debate, we will never get to the end. And I don't think I'm going to deprive you of the bottle, do we? So, good. So don't hesitate to stop me if there is a clarification question. It is my duty to be understood. Okay. Now, here is the first gold coin section, gold line object, back to Lydia. They took many elaborate, more elaborate forms later on, but this was the first time that some authority actually guaranteed the quality of the coins. The next thing is the invention of writing. There are four things that happened at the same time. That's where the box were created, that we're still stuck in, the Sumerian one. The idea that we need a single currency. You could only have one currency, of course, in Holland, or in whatever you need to have. In an economy, you need a single currency. The entire field of economics, from Adam Smith to this day, is making that hidden assumption. By the way, which isn't even true anymore. There are lots of other medium exchange that are being used that are not conventional money, but it's not taken into account in economics. Things like miles. Miles is an agreement within the community to use something else than natural money as a medium of exchange, isn't it? Okay? How many of you have used already a mile? Okay? Did you know we were using a complementary currency?
What's a mile?
Well, Miles. Miles or Smiles or the KLM or that's 40 years old. It's called the loyalty currency. Okay? It convinces you to use the same airline again. So lots of people are using this. This is not small. There are 15,000 billion miles in circulation. This is not marginal stuff, right? And in economics, it doesn't exist. Right? Now, where does the idea of the first of a single currency come from? It comes from Sumer. It was created at the same time as patriarchy, okay? And at the same time as writing. And at the same time as interest. These four things appeared at the same time, in the same civilization. And we're still living with it. We still consider these things totally obvious. As if it's no other way of doing it. The next shift, as I said, was paper money. Actually, it was initially invented in China, in the Ming Dynasty, but here are the European forms. That's the Swedish one. And this is the pound, the English one. And we'll see why they're relevant. Because they were supposed to be paper that actually said that on that place there was some precious metal. That's what I was saying. Then something happened. A war. A war between Sweden and Denmark. In 1658. The king needed money, i.e. gold. Lots of it. And there were a bunch of people who said, that's great, we're going to give you that. But here you sign a piece of paper for us. Now we have the monopoly to create money. On the paper money. The first one to sign up was that guy. The second one was England, also in the war in 1697. That cost 1.6 million pounds sterling. And they got the monopoly of creating money until today. Until today. Nice, right? Talk about an investment. Okay. The Bank of England became the model for every other country. And why did that happen? Well, first of all, that the positive part of that process was the Industrial Age. I claim the Industrial Age would not have happened if we had still been using gold coins. There would never have been the financing available to send guys to conquer India or to do stuff in America or all that stuff. Or invest in mines and all that stuff. The whole Industrial Age was financed with funny money, paper money. Issued by banks. So there's something positive about that because it has created an extraordinary increase of wealth in human history that never had a precedent. And I think we should preserve that, but should we be stuck there is another question. Good. You had the Industrial Revolution, you had the Empire. So everybody why didn't you do the same thing? Every other country decided that it was a good idea. So that model was exported. Universally, the same thing happened in the 20th century for every developing country. First thing they did is get a flag, get a central bank, get a currency. Okay? Playing the same model. This was then transferred to the US. This is a picture of the Bretton Woods Hotel where the negotiations were occurring. That, remarkably, is still intact today. It looks exactly like, I've been there 2-3 years ago, and it's, you could take a picture today and it's still the same thing. Good. Well, then something happened in 71, where the fig leaf was removed. Because on these pieces of paper, they said the real money is somewhere there. And then in 1971, America said, by the way, we moved the big fig leaf and there is nothing below it. Shocking. Now, a dollar is backed by a dollar. You can replace your bill if you went to, or a new bill. That's the extent of replacement that you have. But that's true for all the currencies in the world. So now we have a pure fiat currency. Nothing behind it, except creativity. The power of the word, of a banker. how is the system really working? What is the role of government, given that you said talked about government, what is the role of government and what is the role of the financial system, the banking system? Well, this is the best analysis I've seen so far, which is done by an American called Niall Ferguson. And basically there are four corners. And that is how the system has been institutionalized to remain there, so that everybody considers it absolutely obvious. On the government side, you do have tax bureaucracy, as opposed to tax farmers. In the 17th century, the king would give the right to someone to raise taxes. He would keep a big piece of it, about 50% typically, and give the rest back to the king. That was a very inefficient way of raising taxes, and very often unfair. And the second thing was parliament. Democracy is created. Why? Because it's good. Guess what? By having a parliament, the government can tax more. That is why parliaments were always initially only with the people that were taxed. Only the landowners started being in the parliaments. As more people got taxable, they got more people in parliament. And the last step were women in the 20th century. When they started having their own dynamic, then they can now be taxed, and therefore now they can be parliament. So welcome to the club. All right?
I don't understand.
What don't you understand?
Parliament? You are in parliament to pay taxes.
No. The purpose for parliament in this analysis of power is because with parliament you can require more taxes. You cannot, the government when it extracts taxes from people, it can do this militarily, okay? It can basically send the people to your thing and say, you know, give whatever money you have in your pocket. Not very efficient. By having parliament supposed to be in charge of budgets and therefore of the quantity of taxes to be raised, you are the possibility, the link for doing that. Okay. So, now, that's on the government side. On the financial sector side, there are two pieces, national debt. All these things were put in place for wars. Huh? All the major changes in this process were always to finance wars. That's why having more capacity to extract was important. For parliament, having a better, efficient system to extract taxes was important. The bureaucracy, and then the national debt is a way of spreading it over time. Right? We can have a war over 3 years and then pay for the next 20. Okay? And finally, the central bank. The central bank purpose is not to defend the interest of the people or the interest of the country. It is part of the lobby of the banks. Okay? I have been at the central bank. I left the central bank when I was told by the Secretary General of the Bank of International Settlements, when I was saying there were some problems in the system, he said, Bernard, you don't understand. Central banks exist to keep the system going exactly as it is, not to improve it. Because from the bank perspective, it cannot be improved. You have no better way than having the government enforcing a monopoly in your favor and not taking advantage of it themselves. The government has to require taxes in order to spend it. It could very do differently. They're not doing this for the military duty day. They just have to go play a soldier. Okay? Now, there are two stories around money. What I'm showing you here is what I call the official story. The official story is what's underlying the entire financial press and underlying the entire economics textbooks. Okay? It is that banks are intermediaries. In macroeconomics, they are having a simple equation that says, how many of you had a course in macroeconomics? Okay, same group. Right, good. It says S equals I, right? Remember that one? You know what that means? There are no banks. Savings equals investments. Sorry, guys. Right? It just has made it possible for the entire banking system not to be responsible for anything. Okay? Kenneth Galbraith, made the point that the distinction between macroeconomics and microeconomics has as purpose to hide something. So you don't think of making the connections. And that's one of the key points. So, good. Now, and the second story is that governments are like a family, right? You've heard that one before? You need to earn, either raising taxes, or you need to borrow in order to pay for what you're doing. Bullshit. Not true. The last time that was true was in the Ottoman Empire, when they were issuing gold coins. You needed to get the gold in order to make the coins. Right? This is not true. So, you know, we are being brainwashed, collectively, for 350 years. And we're stuck there. Now, fiat money, as I told you, we now have only fiat money. Means what? Banks create the money. When a bank doesn't have enough reserves, automatically, the central bank issues them to, automatically, this is done electronically, there's not even the guy making a decision. It's happening. every day, they're making the accounting. If the reserve's missing, they send the money out. Period. That's it. Now, governments, by choosing to raise taxes in a currency that it cannot create, gives the power to whoever creates it. Okay? If the government decides that this state will be paid in taxes, the people who make this become very, very powerful. By the way, this was true in the past. When taxes were raised in wheat, the farmers were very important. Okay? So, the government actually has power it doesn't use. And it's the power to choose the currency it raises in taxes. But it never uses it. It behaves as if it doesn't know that it exists. So, finally, that's the other bit, we're in the information age. What is money? Information. And you still believe that won't change? We're still going to get stuck with the Ottoman Empire idea? Okay? I mean, it takes a lot of stretching to believe that that is actually possible. That's what I claim. So the entire field of economics has two hidden assumptions, which are never mentioned. The first one is money is value neutral. It's never said. So we say, well, if you didn't use that money, you would use something else, or whatever, but you would make the same exchanges. We now have enough experience with other types of currency than conventional money, and we can say that the money is not value neutral. Okay? I've already told you about one thing, which is that it makes you short-term thinking, if you're rational, for example. But there are others. Money is not value neutral. Definitely. It's a competitive construct. Good proof of that is very simple. Take €1 million, put it in a normal Dutch family on the table, come back to me and say, everybody's fighting. That's about as neutral as a machine gun that's loaded. Right? And finally, money system is a gift. You know, just like you're living on a place where there's one sun and one moon. It's a gift. Certainly not the decision making. If you have a course in monetary economics, it's about how managing that system. God forbid about thinking that it would be any other possibility. So, both these things are true or not true. And when you leave these two hypotheses, and they both have been proven wrong, okay. Both have been separately proven wrong. We're already living in the multi-currency world. Other forms of medium exchange have been created. And the behavior of people are different with different types of currencies. The kind of exchanges performed are different. and the behavior between the people are different. So we're talking about something else. If we release the hypothesis, things become possible. So why do I think that we need to change? First of all, the system is systemically, structurally unstable. Another little bit. Have you noticed that the media always talk about the crisis as being the last crisis? As being the only crisis. Right? Bullshit. So again, these are statistics from the IMF. We have had, between 1970 and 2010, 145 countries that have gone through a banking crash. Okay? We've had, like we had in 2007, right? We've had 204 monetary collapses, like we avoided with the euro. And we've had 72 sovereign debt crises. Now it's 73 with Greece. That's 425 systemic crashes in countries over 40 years. That's 10 per year. If you had a car like that, with a tractor, or a plane, don't you think that someone would say, send them back to the drawing board? But in the monetary domain, it needs to be safe at any cost. At any cost. And we're doing it. And even before 2070, huh? By 1970, I mean, you have Hindenburg's classics, they're full meltdowns. There were 48 between 1637 in this country, the first country that had it was here, with the Tudors. Okay? And 1929, you have had 48 full collapses. Okay? So it is a systemic, it's a structural problem. The work involving that theoretical part is been what I've been doing the last 6-7 years with a team in the States, with Bob Ulanovich, who is the name indicates is American, right? He spent his entire life, he was one of the founders of quantitative ecology. He has been measuring what happens in natural ecosystems in grams per square meter per year around the world. There are an extraordinary variety of things. The Amazon, Serengeti Plain, the Everglades, a little puddle that size in a court, in the backyard of your house, has a living system. There is an ecosystem there. Microbes are emerging, doing things. Okay? So, what they have in common, all these extraordinary varieties in every climate, is they're all sustainable, right? Nobody is pouring water on the trees that are growing in a forest, in a natural forest. They're just making fine. And if they don't, they die. And that's it. And now something else grows. So the question that we raise is, what else do they have in common besides being sustainable? And the answer is, it requires a balance between two variables. Efficiency, which is measured as the quantity of a complex flow network per unit of time. Okay? By the way, that's GNP per capita in economics, okay? The quantity. That's the efficiency that we measure. And the second thing is resilience, is the capacity to a system to adapt, to change, to survive, when you have an attack, a disease, a drought, whatever it is. That is the second variable. You need the balance between these two. In economics, we only take care of the first one. Resilience is not part of what we do. Now, and we're lucky because what came out is there are two structural variables, diversity and interconnectivity, that influence both these variables. Diversity decreases efficiency but increases resilience. And interconnectivity, which is in a natural system who eats what, okay, decreases efficiency again, if you have a huge variety. But increases. They're fighting each other. They're going in opposite directions. Here's diversity. Okay? And here is interconnectivity. This is a squirrel photographed in Central Park in New York. For the last 50 generations, it hasn't been anything natural, right? Now, this is diversity, mode diversity. This is more efficient. This is more efficient, I insist. However, don't drop a cigarette. Don't drop a piece of glass. Because, told them. Ray of sun, boom, told them. No resilience. That's the consequence. No diversity. And entire, the usual argument that why we need a single currency is because it's more efficient. It's true, because it's also more efficient. But it's not resilient. Now, this is low interconnectivity, very cute animal. It's only one type of bamboo. It's a problem. No resilience. In natural ecosystems, resilience is 3 times more important than efficiency. In economic systems, resilience is not taken into account. And when it does, poof, you have a crash. Now, you say, I'm making a jump, aren't I? I'm making a jump from ecosystems to an economy. Why do I do that? And here's the key. Both these variables, which are the only two variables that were important for creating that balance, are structural. They depend only on the structure of the network, not of what flows in it. So it is applicable to complex flow networks where the same structure behaves the same way, independently of what you circulate in it. That's what's extraordinary. Now, we know that it works for biomass in an ecosystem. You remember the blackouts, the big blackouts that had in Germany and in America, where half the country went gone? They pushed efficiency too far. Same problem. And of course, money in an economy. By having a monoculture, one type of institution that creates one type of medium of exchange, we are actually creating a monoculture. Monocultures are never, 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 never stable. They require a lot of maintenance in order to keep them going. So, and it is applicable to money. Good. To conclude that part, we need monetary diversity to stabilize the existing system, the bank money system. And we need to sacrifice some efficiency. Quantity, GNP is not enough to measure that we are dealing with a sustainable economy. It also makes it possible to create solutions at different scales. There are 4 different peer-reviewed articles that actually demonstrate that, who went the math behind it. The driving force behind it is entropy. Entropy is the most universal law of the universe. It is the source of gravity. Okay? It affects everything. If you argue that this is different from a living system, I agree with you, but gravity applies to both of them, don't they? Right? There's nothing on this planet that is not affected by gravity. This is true also on entropy. And the entire field of economics has ignored entropy. There are 2 guys who tried to bring it in, Salim and Georgescu Röntgen, an impossible name. He has no disciples. The field has been abandoned. Good. How? Here I'm using a metaphor. Let me emphasize that what I've been using on the natural ecosystem is not a metaphor. It is the same laws applying to complex flow networks. You understand the difference here. Okay? It's much more fundamental. This is a metaphor. Let's assume that the normal economy is the ocean, and there are big fish in there, all kinds of things, and lots of movement, and all the big stuff. However, there are things that are not met there. There are unmet needs. lots of them, about a third of humanity doesn't have enough money to survive. That's pretty unmet needs, and you have a lot of other unmet needs that you could think of for yourself. And they're also unused resources. This building is empty probably 70% of the time. It's an unused resource. Okay? So, a complementary currency is a link between these two. Let me give you an example of frequent flyers. What the frequent flyer has purpose is unmet needs, customer loyalty. This is the unmet need of the airliner. They're the ones who do this, issue the currency. That's their interests that are mattering here, okay? Not yours. They want you to go back to the same airline. That's why they do this. So they create customer loyalty, and what do? They link it with an empty seat. And they make sure that seat is empty. That's why you don't try to use it around Easter or Christmas. Huh? Won't work. They have blockout periods, because the airlines are full in these blockouts. So it requires some management. But it works. It has worked for 40 years. In the monetary domain, for social purposes, all I'm talking about is starting to use the same technology for something that matters. Because except for the airline, it doesn't really matter whether I fly with KLM or for Air France to go from here A to B. Nobody cares. The economy doesn't care. Nobody really matters in society. But we can use the same technology of changing behavior, because what airline stuff has shown is two things. Number one, it's possible to have very large scale systems very cheaply. If you needed an army of clerks to keep track of your airline miles, you wouldn't have it, right? So it's part of the information age. And the second thing it does, it's possible to change behavior of people on a long term and a large scale. If it wasn't, they wouldn't do it either. All I'm saying now, let's do this for purposeful things, using that are useful for society. Okay. Three types of examples: governments, businesses, and citizens. This is in Curitiba, Brazil, the capital state of the state of Paraná. You're from Curitiba? Oh, okay, all right. That is what it looked like before. This is the ex-garbage dump of the town. That thing. Okay? They don't need a garbage dump anymore. What did they do? By the way, the garbage was all over the place. In the favelas, in the housing players. And this is the currency. It's a bus token. For any bag of sorted garbage, you get a bus token. The complementary currency is the bus token. And sorted garbage, when it's not sorted, it's a cost item. But when it's sorted, it's an income. You sell it. The glass, aluminum, all that stuff separately, you make money from this. And they have been financing the most advanced bus system in the planet. This is what it looks like. So have you seen long tube here? That's the bus. You have not one door, 20 doors. So everybody, you will get into the system, you pay to get into the tube, and then the doors open, and you go in and out, the whole groups. So it's very efficient to get people in and out. You also get food from local producers for garbage. And this is a development that is quite extraordinary. When the fishes don't bite in the bay, they fish garbage. Okay, to bring back the stuff. So, I myself have been involved in the project and the next one, which is called the Torbus in the city of Ghent, in France, which is not far from here. I was given the worst neighborhood of all of Flanders. Okay? It's economically the poorest neighborhood. 50% are new immigrants. There are 20 languages. Turkish is dominant. We started off with a survey. What is your dream? And the answer was a little garden. That is something, an ex-factory that was destroyed, that went bankrupt 10 years ago, and they destroyed the building. What's left is the soil, which is actually a block of cement. That is what it looks like today. However, a plot of 4 square meters, you can only get with toros, a currency that the city issues. Suddenly, everybody asks, where do you get the toros? Well, here happens to be a long list of things that the city has been trying to convince you to do for the last 20 years and yet done. Like, don't drop the garbage in the street. Put a little label on not having junk mail in your box. When you put a box of flowers on the street side, you'll get 10 toros. And you can rent this piece of 4 square meters for 150 toros per year. They had more volunteers than they knew what to do with. They had to create new programs to basically earn toros. The system has now gone electronic with a college next door. The 3,000 students are getting involved in the process as well. They had more volunteers than they knew what to do with. And with the same euro budget, they had 20 times more results. This is the opening of the inauguration of the city of Yamato in Japan. The love is local value change. An example of a business-to-business system. How many of you have heard of the WIR? Two. The WIR exists since 1934. It exists 80 years. It is the secret for the stability of the Swiss economy. Do you think that's relevant? It's a second currency issued by businesses among themselves. A quarter of all businesses in Switzerland participate. And it is systematically countercyclical. When there is a recession, the volume of beer increases. When there is a boom, it reduces. It stabilizes the economy more effectively than the central banks can. God forbid we hear about that. Right? I think I need to skip this one. This is a currency that is making it profitable to think long term. I can't get into too much detail. Do you know what? Everybody knows what discounted cash flow is? Anybody does not know? Okay, you all know that. Well, then you know. Sorry. If in the world you have two trees, you have pines and oaks, and I'm using inflation-adjusted currency, right? If you have a value of $100 there and $1,000 there, and it takes 10 years, 10 times 4, it would be equivalent, right? It would be indifferent. As soon as you introduce a currency with an interest rate of 5%, this is what happens. The discount to today, the $100 is worth $61, and the oak is worth $7. Nobody is interested in the oaks. Nobody plants oaks. If you have a negative interest rate currency, Paul Dummerage, the oak is worth $168,000. These societies have existed, including in the Central Middle Ages in Europe, negative interest rate currencies. They make you think long term. The Egyptians have done it. They've done it for thousands of years. Result, they built stuff to last forever. What will be remaining from our society besides our nuclear garbage 1,000 years from now? All the rest is going to not exist 20, 50, 100 years from now. We can actually program corporations to think long term. It's involving a commodity basket, and the cost of storage of the commodities would be part of the mechanism, and we'd have a negative interest rate of 3.5% a year. This is a currency that makes it profitable to think long term. I believe we need something like that. It's also a currency that will resist any shock, the dollar collapse, the euro collapse, or anything else. Okay. Other examples. Time is money. It's called time banks. There are about 500 or 600 systems in the world today. There are about 200 or 300 in America. There are about 100 in England. This is the website for the American version. The Fuyakipo in Japan, the aging of society. Japan has currently 498 systems on a local level with is a savings currency in time. I help an elderly person, I get an hour. I can use it myself or send it to my mom, who lives in another part of the country. It makes it much, the government is not involved. This is doesn't cost anything. This is the Ithaca-Hour in Ithaca, New York. Some other systems in Japan, the Kingauer in Germany. There are about 64 regional currencies in Germany, of which 40 are operational. Okay? Job creation. You need things like working capital for small and medium-sized enterprises. This system is operational in Brazil. Brazil is also the country that currently is introducing financing 200 dual currency banks. Banks that operate in two currencies. The national currency and the local currency to reduce poverty. And Brazil is, with China, the country that has the fastest reduced poverty in the last 20 years. That's the tool they're using. Nobody talks about it. Conclusion. If you put in one box all patriarchal societies in history, and I remind you, patriarchy was invented in Sumer in 3200 BC. 5,000 years ago. They will have a monopoly of a centralized currency with interest. All. And the reason for that is it's a way of concentrating resources to the top. It's an extraction device to the top. Makes a lot of sense. If you need an army to keep your power, it's a good way of financing your army, among other things. This has had good things. It has created the Industrial Revolution. It also created the stability booms and bust cycles, concentrates well, and it works well with power. Do you want to know whether you are in a patriarchal society or not? The shortest way I've found so far is the image of the divine. If the world, the universe, has been created by a guy with a bear, without a girlfriend, you're probably in a patriarchal society. Okay, that's trying to disguise itself a little bit. Okay? Now, the nice roles, when the nice role is played by a lady, like had been the case in Egypt with Isis, she is the savior, female savior. Osiris is the poor guy who gets in trouble, and she saves him repeatedly. Right? Or, in the central Middle Ages, the 10th to the 13th century, the Black Madonnas. 80% of the cathedrals were built for Madonnas. And they're still there. What happens in these societies? Dual currency systems. Identical to this one, to trade with people you don't know, long distance. And a second one, a different type of currency, bottom up for local exchanges. A dual currency system. So that creates an environment which has been economic stability for centuries, not for years, like we do. And it has the highest level of living for ordinary people, the bottom quarter of society in Western Europe was the 12th century. Not today. Not today. And we have evidence through the bones, which I'm going to tell you if you're interested. So, I have perpetrated a few books. Sorry. This one is available in 8 languages now, including in Dutch. This is the last report of the Club of Rome about dealing with the money system. This is in the States. This is in England. This is the examples of bottom-up systems. This is something which just came out 2 weeks ago in Belgium. It's been funded by the Flemish government and is a handbook for cities on how to start complementary currencies, like we did in Ghent. So, thank you very much for your attention.